Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Tatiana Show. Today, we have a very special episode. We have more guests than we've ever had because this is going to be the battle of 2016. Steemit lovers and Steemit questioners. May I say haters? I don't know. But that's not what the show is about. It's not about hate. It's about understanding. It's bringing together the community. And I've been using Steemit. I've been having a great time on there. I've met a lot of nice people. Some of the guests that we have today have tried it out. Some of them haven't. But what we wanted to do is get to the bottom of some of the questions that the community has about what is this crazy thing called Steemit. So let me introduce you to our guests. We have several of them today. First of all, I'd like to introduce my co-host, Josh Voltoro. Josh Shigala from Voltoro, the Bitcoin Gold Exchange. Always happy to see you, Josh. How are you doing today? Are you pumped? Okay, well, that's great because you have a mute on your microphone, so I don't know why you think anyone's hearing you talking.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, totally pumped. Everyone's talking about Steemit. Everyone's typing away, adding content, and being paid for it. It's an amazing concept. But I've got some questions, economically speaking, but I'm excited to meet the co-founders, definitely.
Excellent. So our next guests that I'm going to introduce are the co-founders of Steemit. Everybody, this is Dan Larimer, the CTO, and Ned Scott, the CEO. They're both co-founders of Steemit. Welcome to the show, guys. Thanks so much for being on.
Hey, thanks for having us. We're really excited to be here.
Excellent. Very good. Our next guest is the foil, the questioner, the skeptic, Brian Sovryn from Sovryn Tech. Brian, how's it going? Nice to see you today.
Nice to see you too. Nice to see everybody here. This is I'm looking forward to this conversation. So great to be here.
Excellent. And then the last guest that I'm going to bring on is Ryan Singer from Blockchain Health. Now, you might wonder, what the hell does that guy have to do with anything? But Brian is a good friend of mine, and I go to him about all sorts of business questions. So whenever I have a question about Bitcoin, Ryan is one of the first people I call up and I say, what the hell is this thing? And so Ryan actually had some really nice insights as to why Steemit's business model was actually acceptable. And he had some cool things to say about that. So I feel like he will be a good additional voice in this conversation. I'm psyched. How are you doing, Ryan? Are you happy to be here today?
I'm good. I'm in Sunnyvale. I've got background noise, but I hope that it's going to be okay. And I'm excited. This will be fun.
All right, great. So what is Steemit? Who wants to take that question? Probably the inventors of Steemit. Do you guys want to give me a little overview about what is Steemit for the layperson, for people who aren't familiar and living under a rock?
Absolutely. Steemit is a social network, and it is built on a blockchain for all the Bitcoin and blockchain people out there. Everything that you see on Steemit is recorded in the blockchain. So it's one of the first social networks that has sort of immutable data and a built-in cryptocurrency. It's got Steem built in, and it's built in such a way that as people participate and post, they end up earning this cryptocurrency in a way similar to how miners earn Bitcoin as they secure the Bitcoin network. And, you know, it's something that we kind of juxtapose next to all the other social networks we see out there, like Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, who are taking our time, our creativity, our work, and our energy, and then leveraging that along with our personal information, our data, and they are turning that into profits for their shareholders. So as we do all this work for them, they end up reaping all the rewards. And so what we've done is we've created a new model for social networking where the people who participate are the ones who end up benefiting from that.
Okay, that sounds pretty straightforward. There's going to be a lot of questions, I think, going in the future. Now, tell me a little bit, when did you guys launch and how have things developed since you did launch? Because I've done some posts on there. We've got some prominent members of the community, Bitcoiners, that have also been joining. But tell me a little bit more about what the trajectory has been since you guys launched and how you've grown to set us up.
Sure. So Dan and I, we really came together at the beginning of this year. But our history goes back a little bit longer in the Bitcoin space. I came into Bitcoin in 2013. I had studied psychology and economics in school. And the whole concept just felt like a perfect match for me. And I quickly asked Bitcoin to be my girlfriend, and I've spent every night with her ever since. And you know, it was a great experience.
Hang on a minute. So have I.
I think she's probably all of my girlfriends.
He said, "Am
I?" Maybe even Tatiana's girlfriend. I don't know. And you know, it's been a really fun ride being in the Bitcoin space. And there have been other projects, you know, having to do with cryptocurrency and blockchain that you know were referred to as the 2.0 projects, especially when I was getting involved in 2013. And one of those was led by Dan. Now, Dan has a terrific story in the Bitcoin space too. He was one of the first people to discover Bitcoin, and he did so as he was looking for his own digital currency solution. So Dan, how did you come into Bitcoin?
Well, I was always looking for free market solutions for securing life, liberty, and property. And I recognized that currency was one of the biggest things that we would have to find a digital solution for in order to compete with the banking system. So I was trying to figure out how to create a digital currency. And when I was searching for that, that's when I discovered Bitcoin back in 2009. Got involved back then. Fortunately, Satoshi was still around. We got to exchange some messages on Bitcoin Talk. It was an adventure. And over the years, it took me a while to actually get involved full time. Bitcoin was very much like Steem is today back in those early days. But now I've been taking the lessons we've learned from that industry and applying it to applications outside of currency.
So when I found Dan, it was about mid-2013, and he was starting to work on a project called BitShares, which was basically a reaction to one of the business types in the industry, which is the exchange business. We were seeing Mt. Gox and these other exchanges of Bitcoin go under. They were being hacked, or the founders were leaving with the funds. It was a bit of a mess. And the whole idea with BitShares was you could build that business model directly into a blockchain. And as we know, there are certain benefits people get from operating on a blockchain. They're the masters of their own property. And so there was big potential with that project. And Dan, you know, saw it through to completion. There's now a fully operational blockchain-based exchange out there called BitShares. The volume, from what I understand, is still increasing every day. So Dan, having already had a successful blockchain project under his belt, was looking for the next thing. That was about the time that I was ready to make the full leap into the space. So I approached Dan. I said, you know, what's the next thing? What should we be looking at? What's the big consumer play where we can, you know, create something that's really meaningful around the world? And towards the end of 2015, the conversation turned to insurance and mutual aid on the blockchain. We were wondering, how can we connect people in such a way that when they have problems, when they have issues, when they have questions, that a community can rally around them and give them answers and give them solutions and potentially even compensate them when they're in trouble or they have losses. And that led us to a few realizations. We realized that the blockchain needs to support a forum where the communication would be immutable, where people's posts would be inextricably linked to their accounts. And as we started down that road and we saw this forum coming together on the blockchain, we realized that there's some really interesting things we could do. You know, we could actually use the blockchain to incentivize people to post and vote, just like they might on another social network like Facebook or Reddit or Twitter. And that was really neat. We thought it was a compelling story for people to want to come and get involved and be part of the community. And so that was about January this year. And using a lot of the technology that had been developed for these other open source projects, basically, you know, this concept was taken from an idea in January to a mainnet blockchain by the end of March. And it was mined into existence. It was announced on Bitcoin Talk. People came to it. Some looked at the code. They recognized its potential. A few days later, maybe a week or a little bit more later, these were, you know, Steem tokens. The currency on this blockchain is called Steem. Kind of a play on the word esteem. You know, if we were talking about rewarding authors and that sort of thing, you know, you talk about an esteemed author. So you have the name Steem, and those ended up on these cryptocurrency exchanges in April and started trading. And the project organically, you know, generated a lot of interest. And in July, it had explosive growth. People realized that the concept was working. People were reaping the benefits of contributing to this community, and they were earning these crypto tokens. And some were taking them and using them to do things like pay off their loans and pay their rent bills and perhaps buying their mother a washing machine.
Getting out of poverty in Africa.
There was someone, people from all over the world have come to this platform, and some have benefited greatly. And, you know, we're still at the very early stages of this. As you can probably tell from the way I'm describing it, this is an experiment. There's a lot of new concepts here. This point system of social media, kind of like, you know, it's very analogous to if you take Reddit karma. You know, people earn these points for participating online. It just happens to be that these points have value. And, you know, it's a new concept. It's an experiment, and there are aspects to it that I think everyone is still learning about, including ourselves. So we're very excited going forward because there's a lot of potential for this project. We can bring it into a lot of different arenas, whether that's marketplace or what we're referring to as the attention economy, where now that there's this point system with real value, advertisers will have the ability to get the attention of people paying mind and attention to these blockchain-based websites. The advertiser can come in, they can buy cryptocurrency and spend it to get user attention. And what that does is it puts even more value back in the participants in the community's hands. And that's really what this is about. It's bringing everything back to the users.
Okay. That's a really big overview to start with. I don't know why we have that weird echo right now, but we'll just ignore that. Anyway, we have some new people listening to us. From all around the world. I guess people are tuning in. So really quick, we're joined with the co-founders of Steemit, Ned Scott and Dan Larimer. We've got Ryan Singer from Blockchain Health, Josh Agala from Volturo, and Brian from Sovryn Tech. So thanks everybody for joining us. We're talking about Steem. We've got a lot of questions to get through, but before we go forward, can we just identify what the difference is between the three different Steemit currencies, because there is a difference.
Sure, absolutely. Well, you can say Steemit currencies, but Steemit is really just a web application that exists on top of the Steem blockchain, and it competes with several other of these applications. So it might be the most well-known now, but for the users who are just tuning in, they can go to steemtools.com, and they can actually see more than 80 applications built on the Steem blockchain. So when we talk about the tokens, we're really talking about Steem. There's Steem Power, Steem Dollars, and Steem, the core token. Maybe Dan, you want to take this one and talk about the different tokens.
We built a three-token system to solve three different problems that we've identified from my experience with BitShares and other cryptocurrencies. One of these problems is price stability, and so that's where we have the Steem dollar that gives people a token that's not going to fluctuate as wildly as the underlying token would fluctuate. The idea is that people can be exchanged, use that as the currency for commerce without having to worry about volatility or capital gains and losses and all the other challenges that are faced by normal cryptocurrency use. The other challenge we had was long-term commitment. Most startups or communities, you have to invest long-term and stay committed to a project to actually see it through. And a lot of cryptocurrencies, they pump it and then they dump it. And the people who get out first make a lot of money. And it's just a really big problem. And BitShares, we had a voting system. And so anytime votes would go against someone, they'd sell and they'd leave the community. There was no cohesion, no financial incentive to vote in the way that's in the best long-term interest. Everyone had a short-term mindset. So that's where we had Steem Power. Steem Power is just Steem that users have committed for an average of 1 year to the blockchain, which means they can't sell it all at once. They can sell it slowly over time, but it's locked up. That means if when you have your Steem locked up, that's also where your voting rights are.
Your influence.
Your influence, right. So when you're voting on posts and things like that, the more Steem power you have, the more Steem you have locked up for about a year, the more say you have in how much people get paid. And so it aligns all the incentives between the different users.
So that means that, because, you know, it says that I made $2,600 or something from my first post, but when I went to sell some of it, I wasn't able to sell all of it. So part of it is in that Steem power section, and then some of it is in the Steem dollars, which is what I could sell in the open market.
Right.
A couple questions before we move on. So why is it that when I try and sell my Steem dollars, I don't get on Poloniex? I can't figure out how to work it on the Steemit site, but I tried to sell it on Poloniex or however you call it. And it doesn't actually end up being that amount. And then the other half is in the power section. So when it says somebody earns $2,600, I was only able to cash out about 1,000 of that. Does that happen typically? Because I've heard a couple other people have this issue. So can you explain that a little bit?
The payouts that we show are sort of like notional value. It's if you took the price of Steem, times the 1 week moving average of the price of Steem, times the number of Steem power that you got at that time. And that's the estimated value that we show on your account page. And the Steem dollars are, they're just what they are. Now,
there's a loose peg too.
Yeah, it's a loose peg. The Steem dollar is, it's convertible to a amount of Steem that's based on the 1 week moving average, which means that the market traders and speculators, they're buying and selling based upon this convertibility backing. So it's never going to deviate majorly from a dollar, but it is possible for it to deviate by 20% if there's a lot of sell pressure in the short term. But in the long term, if you're patient, you can slowly convert it to Steem and sell the Steem over time, and you'll get approximately a dollar's worth out. But we recognize that you can't have a perfect peg when you've got a volatile currency, the Steem, that's ultimately backing everything. And
is the value peg
is
the peg similar to the BitShares USD, the way you guys peg that by having some?
Yes, it's similar, except in BitShares, the collateral is privatized. In Steem, it's socialized. What we mean by that is the entire blockchain is backing the value of the Steem dollars instead of just the users posting a little bit.
There's some influence taken there from some other great entrepreneurs who have tried these peg instruments, like Robert Sam Sr. at Shares, and you know, Vitalik Buterin had a big part in that conversation too. So it's really an amalgamation of lots of different things to come to something that we think, you know, long run has much more utility than a lot of these other attempts at the peg dollar.
I know that this is really where things start to get interesting, the questioning of the value and all these different kinds of things. So I want to give some of our other guests an opportunity to jump in and to contribute. But before we do, I have two quick questions. Did you say that if I wanted to sell my Steem dollars, I could buy Steem and still get the dollar peg? How does that work? Because now I'm putting in my own money, and then I'm not going to get that money out until 1% a week forever or something like that.
You can use your Steem dollars, and through the blockchain, you can convert it to Steem. Right in your wallet, there's a little menu on convert to Steem that will take your Steem dollars that you already have, and using the price feed, which is the 1 week moving average, it will convert your Steem dollars to a dollar's worth of Steem in 1 week. So 1 week after you do the conversion, you'll have a dollar's worth of Steem, and then you can go and sell it on the market and get a dollar. Now, there's always market fluctuations. Time is always a factor. If you try to sell $100,000 all at once, you're going to get less than if you spread it out over time. This is just the nature of markets, supply and demand. Price feeds represent the marginal price of one unit, not necessarily the price of all units. So when you're trying to estimate the value, these are all estimates using the same type of techniques you use in the financial industry to estimate stocks and market caps and things like that. But ultimately, all value is backed by the free markets, supply and demand, people wanting to buy Steem for influence, buy Steem for speculative purposes. We have no promises that Steem has any value. The only thing we do with the Steem dollars is we make sure that the ratio of Steem dollars to the entire market cap is less than 10% at all times, and it's currently around 2%.
Right, and that's something that's enforced by the blockchain. One of the neat things about this, and it's consistent with, you know, all these other cryptocurrency projects, is that all the rules of how these tokens work is baked into the blockchain. And it's all there, it's open source, it's auditable. Anyone can show up and learn how it works that way. And you know, that gives it robustness too. There's no person involved making this work. It's all mechanical, distributed, controlled by nodes around the world that have nothing to do with Dan or I.
Yeah, we don't actually operate the primary nodes for securing the network. So.
Okay, so I have so many people that want to ask questions. I have one more. It's my show, I'm allowed. If I try and power down my Steem, the Steem power or whatever, the one that you're supposed to power down, not the thing at the bottom, If then it starts issuing me money every week, but does that mean that any additional posts that I make don't go toward that? Am I not allowed to participate anymore, or what's the story?
Your Steem power is, each week your Steem power will decline and your Steem will increase. So your influence in the system will slowly decline, but you can still post, you can still vote, and until it gets converted from Steem power to Steem, you still have the full use of your influence and your Steem power. Once you do get your Steem, you should either use it to buy Steem dollars or sell your Steem for Steem dollars, or if you want to go buy something else, you can sell it on the markets for Bitcoin or dollars.
Just yesterday, somebody put up a post that they had constructed a marketplace based on Steem. It's called peerhub.com. It's put together by an entrepreneur named June based out in California. He did an amazing job with it. And just yesterday, for the first time, I went to this marketplace and I started buying things. I bought a mug, I bought a t-shirt, all sorts of things. So hopefully over time, Tatiana, you'll be able to, instead of taking these Steem and going to other markets, you'll be able to stay in this market and use it to purchase all the things you might need for your life.
Yeah, you can already purchase gold on Voltoro through the shapeshift thing with Steem. So
yeah. You can go right to Voltoro and get your gold.
You can buy gold with Steem, guys. All right. So now I wanna bring the focus over to Brian and Ryan because they both have some questions. Who wants to go first? Ryan is asking. Brian, you're going to be right after Ryan. Okay.
Yeah, Ryan. I'm unmute.
Ryan, go for it. You're on mute, but we're ready to hear you now.
Hi. So I really find it fascinating, the idea of running one of these social media platforms directly on a blockchain and having the logic for compensation and advertising and stuff like that on the blockchain. But it kind of begs a question that you don't normally see on these platforms, right? So if you look at how Dan and Ned have been talking about Steem, sometimes it sounds like they're talking about a company, and sometimes it sounds like they're talking about a blockchain. And it's very difficult to tell the difference between those two things, especially when Dan says things like, we try to keep the Steem dollar amounts under 10% of market cap, and even just using phrases like market cap or socialized staking for the Steem dollars, right? It was another one. So right now, there are, 2.2 or so million Steem dollars out there. And the Steem has a market cap of $63 million. So I can understand the idea that Steem as a blockchain is a balance sheet and that that's backing those $2 million or so in debt. That makes sense to me. My question is how are kind of corporate decisions made there where when you change the rules of how Steem dollars interacts with Steem, or you change the rules about how author rewards are given and stuff like that, do those conversations happen internally at Steemit.com? Is that software development done internally at Steemit.com? You know, what happens before the hard fork, and then how does the discussion of how the hard fork happens to the blockchain that changes the rules, how does that discussion happen?
The Steem blockchain is built off of a governance model derived from what we did with BitShares. All the stakeholders who have committed long-term with their Steem power, they get to elect through approval voting over 19 different individuals.
The consensus model here is called delegated proof of stake. And as Dan's saying, he worked on it, he began working on it several years ago. And what it really means is that the token holders, the points holders, get to vote on who makes the decisions for upgrades. So we, as a company, we look at the site and we want to, improve certain things sometimes. But I will tell you, it has been very difficult to get changes through on occasion because we have this community who is really, behind these decisions. So what we do is, we might develop some software, but it never ever goes into effect unless the witnesses, who are these block producers, choose to upgrade, and they do. They would have to have a majority vote to make that happen. So we might present them new software, but if they don't choose to accept it, then no changes go into effect. And we've seen that in a number of cases where recently we've said, why don't we experiment with the way voting works? And we've been flat out rejected. People have seen no change. And so nothing has changed there. And that's maybe for the better. I think a lot of these systems, they say a rolling stone gathers no moss, right? And I think we're at the point now where this platform is growing. The community is getting larger every day. And people appreciate stability. So, there's a balance to strike here between offering the blockchain, improvements and allowing it to be completely stable.
There are two types of changes in general. There's the controversial ones that change perceived property rights. And then there's the uncontroversial ones that add new features, add new capabilities, but don't take anything away from people. So the governance model works really well when we're adding new features like hacked account recovery, lost password recovery, savings accounts where you have delayed transfers so that if your account gets hacked, you can still cancel any withdrawals as long as you can recover it fast enough. We've added a lot of these types of features that don't affect anyone's property rights, but they enhance the overall smart contract of the blockchain itself to benefit everyone. And so the community can agree to upgrade to the new set of features and adopt the new rules. And unlike other blockchains, it actually agrees on the hard fork. So if the community votes to have a hard fork, all the nodes that don't know the code for the hard fork automatically shut down and yield when the hard fork hits, because the decision to hard fork is a decision to kill the old fork simultaneously, and so we don't end up with Ethereum classic Ethereum type situations on the Steem blockchain.
Well, thank God for that. So one last question and then I'll pass it over to Brian. So I get the idea that the governance is made by this delegated model where all of the Steem power holders, which are I guess analogous to shareholders, vote for witnesses, which I guess are analogous to board of directors, and the witnesses make all the decisions about when the software changes, right? You guys, as a company, propose software changes, some of which get accepted, some of which get rejected. That's pretty cool. My last question is there some kind of forum where the witnesses discuss pending forks or pending software changes, or does that only happen on the site itself?
Well, it happens directly on the blockchain, which could be on Steemit.com or it could be any number of sites. We also have some chatting groups and some other means of communication with the core witnesses.
Ryan, I don't think I'm even aware of all the communication channels, but there are certainly some off-chain. There's several Slack groups where these witnesses hang out and talk to the different community members. There's Steemit chat, which is one that we link to from our site. There's a couple Slack groups that we're in. So it's a bit dispersed. It's a bit disorganized, where, you know, you have these distributed systems and not all these people are part of the same company. So it's a bit like herding cats sometimes when you want to get their attention, but it still comes together, especially when the communication is on chain.
And most of the big decisions, the controversial concepts, are discussed and debated in detail on the blockchain for everyone to see. It's the private coordination, the testing, the debugging, the bug reporting that happens through other channels. But the big decisions happen in public on the blockchain for everyone to see.
Cool. Thank you so much. I'm going to go back on mute to protect you guys from my background noise. And Brian, it's your show now.
Thanks, Ryan.
Wait. Before Brian says anything, I just want to just interrupt and say thank you, everybody who's watching. We're here with the co-founders of Steemit, Ryan Singer from Blockchain Health, Josh from Volturo, and Brian from Sovryn Tech, and also Sex and Science Hour, big fan. Thanks to our sponsors, CryptoCompare.com, FreeRoss.org, and the BitcoinCPA.com. Carry on.
Okay, yeah, so my questions, I kind of have like a small series. They should be, you know, pretty simple to answer. I don't know that they need a lot of explanation. But kind of the first one, and maybe you've already sort of answered or given what your answer is going to be, but I just kind of want to hear it a little more direct. Like, why, I understand the social media aspect of this. I think I'm correct, and you can tell me if I'm not. I'm correct in that Steem, not just Steemit, but Steem is more than just a social media. That's kind of just like almost a pilot program or an experiment, as you described it. Am I right about that part before I go further?
Steem is a community of people working together to build something. They can work to vote on anything they like, to reward people for doing anything that adds value to the platform. It's not just necessarily a social media. Social media is how we communicate. It's how we recognize contributions. But you don't have to write a brilliant post to get a lot of upvotes for saving us from a security vulnerability.
So a lot of people get rewarded for developing new tools that work off of the Steem blockchain. So it's not just blog posts. It's posts about statistics, it's new applications, it's
buying billboards.
There's marketing done by the community.
Charities.
It's this decentralized group of people. They're not part of our company, but they're all rewarding each other and participating in this network of distributed value.
It's a subjective meritocracy. I can't even speak that right now. But yes, it's a way for everyone to have subjective judgments of value that is massive collaborative budgeting of stake. And as people continue to contribute, one of our big ideas here is that everyone who contributes should receive Steem proportional to what they contributed, but recognizing that all value is subjective. But the idea that it doesn't just have to be about a social media platform. You could use this to build something like a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin, where the difference is that instead of allocating it to people who burn electricity, you're allocating it to people who do anything else that benefits the ecosystem. Mm-hmm.
And there's a play here too, which is, you know, but it's a new type of community where reputation and identity matter because there's value on the line, these points that have value. People actually behave somewhat differently where, you know, everything they do, they want to build on their reputation and there's an opportunity cost for trolling and that sort of thing. So it creates a really excellent environment of collaboration. So what we really want to get to in the long run, what we see, you know, for the community is this small town environment where everybody kind of feels like they know everyone. And that helps in commerce, that helps in social interaction. So it's much more than just social media. It's hopefully going to be a very supportive community in many different, you know, segments of people's lives.
Right. Yeah. So it's a whole platform. It's not just social media. I think some of my questions here, you know, would apply more to the social media aspect of it. I just wanted to be clear that, like, it's not, we're not just going after some new, or, you know, we're not just talking about some new Facebook here. There's a whole lot more to it, which I can certainly appreciate. I'd love to respond to some of the ID and reputation stuff, but I'll save that. So I guess I'm wondering, with everything, including everything you just said, like, why does this need to be on a blockchain? I mean, like you might have already answered that earlier on. I'm curious what your answer is to kind of the direct question of that.
You go on a blockchain because blockchains create a public record that's verifiable. It builds trust. It means that no one, you don't have to worry about anyone changing things, censoring things after the fact. There's this public record, which is critical for trust. It's what gives Bitcoin its value, and it's actually what gives Steem most of its value. You could build Steem on a
MySQL database.
On a MySQL database, but people wouldn't trust it. It's just a point system. The database could get shut down at any time. There's no proof that the users interacted in a certain way. We could change anyone's account. We can make anyone appear to say anything. You're basically trusting with what
we're doing. Right, so you're looking for that record. Like that's kind of the gist of why. Am I boiling that down?
Immutable is part of it, but also authenticated record. Individual actions cannot be forged by us.
Right. So that contributes to reputation and identity. So as this becomes a bigger platform than just social media, people will be able to audit all of the people that they do business with. And, you know, so trust is more than just the point system. It's across the board. It's important.
Sure. So I guess that leads to my next question. And that is like, why create Steem? You know, why create your own coin? Because, you know, you have Alexandria, which uses, Florin coin or whatever. I mean, that have actually been integrated with social media already to where it's like saving tweets to kind of create that immutable record or the, you know, the hashing with authentication, right? So why a new coin or three coins actually?
Incentives matter. And there are special incentives built into Steem. It's designed to reward people in a certain way. What there really is here is there's kind of like a fire hose of these tokens, and the community gets to decide where to direct that. And I don't believe we have seen anything like this in any other cryptocurrency out there. And it's just not possible to take another cryptocurrency and warp it. In the same way we were talking about, you know, it's hard for us to make changes to Steem. It's even harder to take a concept like this and throw it into a different cryptocurrency. It's a different set of rules.
There's economic reasons and there's technical reasons. The economic reasons are the fact that we use the so-called printing press to distribute funds and rewards, which is how we get around the micropayment problem.
By we, we're talking about the blockchain. This is the Steem blockchain with its set of rules.
Correct. Yeah, the Steem blockchain gets around the micropayment problem because there's no decision to buy. You just upvote, and not spending your money, you're spending community money. And that completely changes the mental process, the decision, the purchase. Because whether you vote or not, the money's going to be allocated to someone. You're just helping steer it. And the money is allocated at the same rate that Bitcoin has been allocated. About 10% a year of the Steem market cap is being distributed to people doing new things. Bitcoin has had that for most of its life, except for very recently, since the recent halving. It's been much higher than that. So yeah, that's part of it. The other part is technical. When you look at a social media website like Reddit, we estimate they need 225 transactions per second on average just to process their votes and their posts. And that's far beyond what any blockchain has publicly demonstrated, but the Steem blockchain is capable of doing that. The other is transaction fees. If people are going to vote, and you want to do that vote and log on the blockchain, or they're going to post, or they're going to comment, they don't want to pay a transaction fee. And any other cryptocurrency you use is going to charge even a couple cents of transaction fees is too much. Even a fraction of a cent is too much, because it means in order to get involved, you first got to put money in. And when we designed Steem, we wanted to allow anyone to put their time in and work their way in rather than just putting their money in.
Imagine you go to Facebook and you see your friend's post and you just want to give them a like. It's going to cost you 5 cents on any other blockchain. So what we came up with is called bandwidth rate limiting. And so this blockchain is able to calculate how many tokens are in an account and then allow that account to take a certain number of actions across a certain period of time. And, you know, that's a major, has major implications for how we're able to to handle social media and these basic user actions on a blockchain.
Yeah. I can appreciate the technical aspect. I think actually that makes sense, that you need to be able to do so many transactions in such and so much time, and there really isn't another blockchain, at least at the moment, that could be able to do that. That makes a lot of sense to me. I guess this will be the last question. I'm actually interested to hear Josh ask some of the economic questions. But my last bit is that I really do want like these alternative spaces, and I'm all about like altcoins, and you know, I think in a freer market you're going to have, you know, thousands of these kinds of things, and I think that's wonderful. But my question is that really I haven't seen a monetized social media platform that genuinely incentivize quality. It always just seems to incentivize on human stupidity, to where like, and I'm not saying you guys are, I'm saying like in general, people go for clickbait. There's a reason BuzzFeed is really popular. There's a reason a lot of these sites take off. There's a reason why Facebook has to change their algorithm to stop a lot of these clickbaity headlines, because it's clogging up their system. And I, you know, I'm curious, do you have anything to somehow, like, I get that the content is the value, but like I debate that really the internet or the abstract concept of social media itself really allows intellectual content, or, you know, value subjective, of course, but that incentivize really intellectual content and something that's genuinely worthwhile. Go ahead.
Have you been on the site lately? We have attracted some of the most intelligent people that I've ever met in my life, from Jeff Berwick to Sterling Lewis.
That's debatable, but okay.
I hope he's watching.
Well, I'm just saying, I mean, you know, three paragraphs in a picture shouldn't be making $15,000. I think you guys kind of, I mean.
Over time, and it has gotten better. When we started out, I think that there was a lot of that. There was two sentences getting huge upvotes, and then it's grown, you know, and now there's more of a baseline. There are community voting guilds where people get together and they say, as a collective, we won't vote on these things unless they meet certain criteria, unless this author is a real person, unless they put in the work, unless this content is original, unless it's a great perspective, it won't get the upvotes. And as we move forward, we can expect those standards to become more stringent and to produce better and better content.
The way I compare it is early on mining Bitcoin, it was very easy and it's extremely profitable. And there's a sort of a reverse auction where people are bidding more and more work for the same amount of reward. And that bid of more work shows up in increased quality, increased quantity. And as users, there is financial incentive to vote in ways that cause people to want to stay around. Because if you vote to reward garbage, you're not going to want to stay around yourself. And it's that extra financial incentive, that extra motivation. There's this concept, if you don't want to see someone getting paid for garbage, it basically repulses people. And there's a lot of people like, why does this person deserve $20,000? And because of that, people say, well, I can do better. And they go and they do better, and then that drives content up. And so over time, free market economics will cause the supply of quality to reach the demand of the amount of steam that we're creating each day.
The blockchain.
Yeah. It'd be like Bitcoin mining until eventually you have to really do a lot of work to get the rewards. And that's the same trajectory as Bitcoin. You went from CPUs to GPUs to ASICs. And in this case, the proof of work is subjective. And the opinion of the community is going to get more and more discerning, which means you're going to have to do more and more work for the same amount of steam.
Yeah, I'm not too clear on the value part. I haven't really been. I don't think that's quite been worked out. Also, don't the original investors in Steem, being partially you guys, because you guys have obviously hold some Steem. Doesn't the fact that they can vote for things skew the results as well? I mean, you're going to want to vote up things that are like, Steem is the best thing I ever saw. And then maybe something really controversial, like Steem sucks. And then everything else is kind of like, oh, if it's not about Steem, it doesn't really seem to gain any steam.
I think we saw a lot of that in the beginning. You know, it was kind of the low, you know, there wasn't enough competition in the market early on, and it was the easiest to agree with other people about Steem as decent content. But the platform has moved away from that, and I think collectively the community has said we're not going to attract a lot more people if we keep posting about Steem. So we've seen a shift away from that. Now we're seeing posts about poetry and all sorts of fiction writing and, you know, nature and gardening and hiking and traveling and all sorts of real world, you know, contributions. And, you know, like we said, we expect to see more and more of that.
When you compare it to how Reddit got its start, it was all pornography for the first couple of years, and then it evolved. So we start out talking about Steemit and evolve from there. I think that's a pretty good starting place. The other thing is, it's a market. The participants in the market have supply and demand. If there's demand for more information about people learning about Steem, the market's going to supply and they're going to get the votes. After the audience gets tired of it, the demand falls off, there's less interest in it, the market moves on to produce other things that people are interested in.
Yeah, but you're the market in this case. So I don't know if it's just as open, it's just like a free market, because, you know.
The market, we also have the biggest financial incentive to vote in ways to maximize the value of what we have, because if we vote poorly, we lose a lot.
So as an individual, I actually don't think I'm a very good curator. One of the proposals that we're making to the Steem community, and hopefully we'll be able to make it technically in the next couple months, is the idea of curation guilds, which basically allows people to come together to set these standards, to lend out their influence and their voting power. So I could literally, Tatiana, give you my influence because I know you'd be a great curator, and you can take it and you can vote up all the things you like and basically, you know, help make the community better and help reward yourself for being a great curator. So there's still a ways to go, but we can see a path towards getting to very, very good content and a very insightful and thoughtful community.
You know, if I could just interject one more thing. Something I'm not impressed by the project at all. I know, Tatiana, you've had them on your show recently, but the scenario, it's S-Y-N-E-R-E-O. I'm not a fan of what they're doing, but one thing I did appreciate that they did, they actually, as I understand it, they did an AMP is their, that's their Steem dollar, that's their currency, whatever. And they did a burn of pretty much all, like, the initial, I don't know, whatever, setup of AMP. And that was to show that they weren't going to, you know, that the developers themselves and all that weren't going to be taking control of the network. Now, I mean, I guess I wonder, you know, Ned and Dan, I mean, don't you think people would feel a little more confident about it if there wasn't, like, these whales? I mean, there is kind of a whale problem. Maybe they trust you, but, you know, there's a lot of people that were very early on that have a ton of influence and maybe, you know, a very undue amount of influence or a concerning amount of influence. It's not undue because they invested early, so, you know, there's some deserving there. But yeah, I mean, would you ever consider anything like that, or how do you even feel about that?
I think that's the Curation Guild proposal. Yeah. Essentially, I think most of these whales, and, you know, some of them are still kind of anonymous, and we really don't know them, but, you know, through communication on the blockchain and all that, we have seen that people, all of these people, want to see better curation because it is valuable to the community. So the Curation Guild proposal is one way to make that better. Where you can take one person influencing the site and that person can distribute their influence amongst many people without giving up, you know, any of their economic incentives to hold on to it, or they can give the economic incentives away as well.
And what we're working on building behind the scenes is ways of identifying unique users. And as soon as we have the technology and infrastructure to prevent people from fraudulently claiming rewards, we will be distributing a larger percentage of the Steem that we mined to users as incentives for signing up, as incentives for referring people. But we have to make sure that we have a system that is robust against fraud, because systems like Stellar did this, and all the tokens were taken up by people who spammed it with fake Facebook accounts and the like. And that is ultimately very bad for the platform, because it means it goes from the hands of someone who cares about the platform to someone who's willing to just steal whatever they can. But once we have that in place, then we will be distributing a lot of our power. We have no interest in controlling the entire blockchain, and we want to distribute that control to others as quickly as possible. But, you know, when it's sort of like a new life, early on, you need a baby needs its parents to take care of it. But as it grows up, the parents need to let go and let it go on. And that's what happened with BitShares. And
it's what happened with Bitcoin, too.
Yeah.
You know, Satoshi was there early on and then he went his own way and Bitcoin continued to grow and get stronger.
So early on, our control is, you know, it's there to protect the system until it's able to gain enough people, enough entrepreneurs and businesses. And
I think we've already seen that Steem is growing up. And we see that in that the community is starting to say, guys, we got this. You know, this is how you should move things. This is how the blockchain should move and change and grow. And that's really valuable for everyone. It's valuable for us. It allows us to be more hands-off and let this thing grow on its own. So we're very excited to let this thing distribute more and become more decentralized. And
we would like to get the blockchain to a feature-complete point where we're not adding new features and where the blockchain is basically frozen like Bitcoin, except for maybe critical bug fixes. That's where we'd like to get to be, and we're, you know, it's still beta right now. And as we mature, it's going to finalize, and we'll have the final protocol that is.
It's a very new step in software development, isn't it? Because usually software is a constantly evolving thing; it's never perfect. That's hard with blockchains.
If you're trying to design a game like Second Life, World of Warcraft, or
Diablo 2, StarCraft, any of these.
You've got to balance the the shield versus attack powers of various options in order for the game to be fun and playable and to be balanced. Yeah. And it's really hard to know how all the economic incentives are going to balance out in advance. You almost have to experiment on a live user base. We're learning those things. Tweaking the rules.
That's very true. The whole gaming, as soon as you come out with some rule sets, someone will figure out how to game the system that you would have never have seen in a testing phase. And I guess you'll only see in a live scenario with thousands of bright sparks trying to get as much as they can out of self-interest. So just a quick rapid-fire question. First of all, we see 100% inflation. Is that correct? There's 100% inflation per year Steem?
Technically, it's more like a stock split. Every year, there's a 2-to-1 stock split, which would represent 100% inflation. But the stock split is disproportional. About 10% is allocated to new users and content contributors. The other 90% is just distributed back to the people who already had it. So it's not a transfer of wealth. And every 3.5 years, there's a reverse stock split, which keeps the supply relatively stable. So if you look at it in terms of implementing this without inflation, it's basically a 10% a year tax on the to reallocate the funds to
this. Is this a gradual split? Is this happening gradually, or is this going to be like Bitcoin, a halving every 4 years?
The reverse split is every 3.5 years, approximately, and the rest of it is continual growth.
That's the reason we've seen quite a dip in the price of Steem over the last, since sort of January, July the 18th kind of area.
Well, when was the last time I was on this show? I think it was March or April, Tatiana. I think that Steem was on the markets trading around, I don't know, 6 million, 10 million. I'd have to go back and check. But it's up from there. And what we've seen, from that moment, we saw a massive rise that we could not have predicted and we were not expecting.
All thanks to the Tatiana show.
All thanks to this show. So what we're seeing now, it's market forces, it's consolidation. Do we know?
Okay, so it's a price discovery phase that you see. I constantly tell people also that my theory of Bitcoin's volatility in the start was especially that nobody knew what this thing is worth. No one knew the power of this this beast called Bitcoin. Is it worth $1 billion a coin? Is it worth 10 cents? No one knew. So the market's trying to discover the price fairly, and that takes time and it takes volatility. The other problem I wanted to, or not problem, but question was about these the whales, I guess. And this is, I'm sorry to bring this up all the time, and I know it's something you guys are probably dealing with a lot, but that 45 people have like 50% of Steem it, and 250 people have about 80%. Is this, I mean, for me, I don't see it as a major problem if it's, I don't care if there's a lot of, if there's a few rich people, and it doesn't, because things just spread around and people tend up spending and investing that. But on Steem, it seems like they have power, but you already answered this question with gilding, with allowing that to be loaned out. So I think that is already covered. The question also, how can you see the raw data? Is there a way, because I noticed I edited my post quickly because I saw a spelling mistake and I wanted to add some stuff. And then I couldn't see, you know, a history of my edits, and I would have thought that would have been something a blockchain would be useful for.
It's possible to generate the history. We just haven't done the proper indexes on the blockchain to produce that history. So it's possible to reconstruct it. It's possible to build an interface that would display it. And people are probably creating tools to do that as we speak. It's just, you know, not part of the minimal viable product that we launched to market.
Okay. And is there a way for people to get paid for developing more functionality to Steem it?
Yeah.
There's a few ways.
You have to do is develop it, create a web page, make a post describing what you did, and report on your progress, and you'll get upvotes, and you'll make a lot more money.
It's possible to make more money. If the community appreciates the work that you're putting in, and you're posting it in a way where they can actually give you those upvotes, and those upvotes are turning into Steem, you're earning for your work. There's other ways too. I mean, some of these witnesses have campaigned for, some of these developers have campaigned for witness positions. And that's basically, hey, I'll be a block producer for Steem. I will also build XYZ tools for Steem. So we have seen it work that way as well. Some of these whales are also sponsoring some of these additional projects, which is also pretty cool.
As a whale, when I see someone who puts significant work, as far as I can tell, they put time and energy producing something that improves the ecosystem, they get my upvote, because that's incredibly valuable. It's something that'll pay dividends for the platform over the long run. Far more than just even the best post about some news today, right? This is core infrastructure.
And quickly, the last question before we get to audience questions, because there's a few of them there. How big is this blockchain? I mean, people must, you know, if every single post is going on onto the blockchain, or how are you dealing with that data bloat?
It's manageable because of delegated proof of stake. In terms of people running, you know, full nodes, not everyone needs to run a full node. The network is secure with a certain number of them, you know, running around the world. But Dan can answer more.
The blockchain right now is, I believe, about 1 gigabyte. If you're running the minimal node, it's using about 1 gigabyte of RAM. It's manageable. It's the current transaction rate is about half of Bitcoin. It's been as high as Bitcoin in terms of transactions per second and bandwidth, and the rate at which the blockchain grows. So that's the raw size. The resource requirements do grow, but the financial incentives and compensation is there for the people who operate the nodes to buy high-end servers with fiber optic connections to the internet with terabytes of RAM, to keep this blockchain operational and still be profitable.
Okay. Do we have any more questions from our guests? I feel like this has been a very robust discussion. I'm kind of annoyed that there hasn't been any kind of throwing of things, but whatever. I don't know why you guys don't want to get me bigger ratings. Talking like Geraldo style. Just kidding. So we have some audience questions, though. Do any of our panelists or whatever we want to call ourselves, does anybody else have any questions before I take it to the streets? No? Okay, great.
I have tons, but we'd be here all day. So, and I appreciate these guys' time. So let's, yeah.
Okay. So can you explain why you say redistribution will happen while whales continue to grow in size while powering down? And then also somebody else says, the same person, why do we see the same 20 people on the homepage for the last 2 months?
Well, there's several things. The statistics show that the top 100 accounts as a total, their combined percentage of the Steem market cap is falling by about 0.5% each and every week. And there's regular reports coming out every weekend for the past month or so that have shown this trend of the largest account holders
losing their influence,
losing their percentage stake in the platform. And that's because it's very hard to produce enough content to actually get voted on yourself to keep up with the rate at which the system's decentralizing itself to more people. The reason you see the same people is...
Well, I don't know if that's even not true.
It's not completely true, but there's this 80-20 principle that exists in all of nature and all of economics, and it's that 20% of the people end up producing 80% of the value. And it's not saying anything about, you know, people aren't bad. It's not saying the system's broken. It's just the nature of reality and markets.
And if there is, you know, some semblance of truth to it, you know, like I said, if I were the only one curating, the site would not be very diverse. You know, it would be stagnant. So we've talked about other solutions like curation guilds and things like this
that are designed to
distribute influence and get more of these value producers to the top of the site.
Just this week, we introduced the concept of reblogging or re-steaming, where if you see an article you like, you can share that article with everyone who's following you. That is just one example of ways that we're working to help spread content, spread information. This is just an information sharing discovery problem that everyone has. The entire internet is fighting for users' attention, and Steem is just a small microcosm of the greater whole.
One thing I'm really looking forward to, Tatiana, is the element of profiles and identity and more reputation tools and badges for different things. So a lot of these people come to the platform and they want to get the community's attention. Well, in the future, one of the ways they're going to do that is they're going to have a more decorated profile, because people want to connect with other people. They want to understand other people and know other people before they're giving them their support. So I think that that's one thing that will help in the short term. But in the long term, I expect to see a multitude of these improvements to help distribute the influence and make things more fluid and better.
One thing is certain, that if you had a company and the CEO voted to pay himself everything, and the employees nothing, the company would go bankrupt and the CEO would also be broke. The large stakeholders have no financial incentives to pay everything to themselves, because if they do, that's going to kill the goose that's laying the golden eggs.
Yeah, but I think in your the complexity of Steemit, I agree with what you're saying there, Dan, but I think there might be a wrench in that, because there's some of that money that you can't access, right? There's the Steem power that you can't touch for like a year. I feel like I feel like that does, while there's an incentivization of spending within like the kind of this tri-monetary system, I'm not sure exactly how to describe that. I worry that there might be some odd incentives around the Steem power itself, where it's not just as simple as, like, you know, they're incentivized to, work in the way you were just describing. So I'm just putting that out there.
It's an experiment. We're trying our best to align the rules and the incentives so that when everyone acts selfishly, the whole community benefits.
Right. If you're caught acting selfishly, the community can actually turn on these people. So potentially you can lose reputation, you can lose face, you can hurt your chances at future rewards.
We have a question from, I'm sorry, did that finish your question, Brian? Yeah. Okay. Okay, we've got a question from Sergey Simonovsky. What are you planning to do with the amount of plagiarism on Steemit, and are you planning to introduce languages recognition so if somebody speaks a different language, they can, you know, only see posts in their own language, that type of thing?
I think we've touched on this a bit with all the identity and reputation, you know, the badges and the profiles that all get caked in will all help reduce people's ability to plagiarize and get away with it. We have seen the community respond to that sort of behavior with vigor. There's a whole group of individuals that have come together by themselves to use plagiarism detectors to find that sort of content and make the community aware of it, to leave comments below those posts saying this is plagiarized from this place and this place. And over time, it will just become a more and more reliable filter for that sort of behavior and that sort of content.
The people you follow have a big impact on the content you see. And once you discover someone is plagiarized and they get that reputation, people stop following, their content stops trending. There's people out there that will point out, say, hey, this thing has tricked some people, and people come along and downvote it to correct the situation. No one likes to see someone cheating the system. There's very little we can do in terms of automated tools because the AI content spinning algorithms are so advanced that it's not as simple as just doing a Google search for the text and finding where it came from. Early on, that type of thing worked. We had people in the community creating bots to identify it. But, you know, there's a arms race between the people trying to cheat the system and those trying to defend it. So
I find it funny.
The community has rallied to, you know, put more and more of these tools in place. As we move forward, they'll only become more and more advanced. Identity and reputation will only matter more and more. And I cannot see this being a long-term problem.
Yep. Ryan, I'd love to hear your take.
Yeah, I find it funny that a lot of the people who complain about the top 1% of Steem accounts owning, what is it, 91% of the Steem, and the top 10% of Steem accounts owning 99% of the Steem, basically, are often the same people who are concerned about spam on the system. But because the curation is not one account, one vote, but instead one share, one vote, these are two problems that can't possibly be both getting worse at the same time, right? Because either the small number of curators is choosing the things that reflect their preferences, and you're not going to see any spam they don't like, or the spam is proliferating, and so is the voting power. And so, like, I just don't get it. Like, if I wanted to get a piece of spam onto the front page of Steemit, the only method I know how is to try and incentivize Ned or Dan or some other big whale outside of the platform to vote it up.
There's a strong culture against vote buying too.
Yeah, which would make a lot of sense. Cool. So one last question for me, and then I think I'm going to hop off. So when we were talking about inflation, it got kind of confused a little bit about the stock splitting, stock bonding stuff. Just to make it really clear, so right now the people who own Steem Power own about 94% of all of the Steem. And so that current exact population, what percentage of the Steem will they own in 12 months?
If you let this run and assume everything is equal, the system equalizes around the Steem power holders owning 90%. So if Steem power holders are facing a much lower rate of inflation than liquid Steem holders, and the market forces and the mathematics behind the platform will push it toward 90%. Anytime less than 90% is held by Steem power holders, they actually get an inflation adjusted positive return on their investment. So if it ever goes down to steam power representing, say, 80%, then over the course of a year, it's going to be moving those people up to 90% just because they're getting stock splits in their favor.
Okay, that makes it a lot more clear. And I knew I said that was the last one, but I'm going to do a follow-up because that was so good. So I can see all of the things I can do with steam power. I can vote up other posts. I can delegate to witnesses. I can, it's really the tool for governing the platform. And I can see what I like about Steem dollars, right? I'm earning interest. I can pay someone in something that feels dollar denominated. But what is Steem useful for other than getting Steem power or Steem dollars, if anything?
That's exactly what it's useful for. It's you want to melt some of your Steem power, make it liquid so that you can trade it with other people who want to get into Steem power.
Yeah, it's kind of like with Steem, you have complete freedom. You have all the flexibility that you have with Bitcoin. It's cross borders, it's fungible, it's easy to move around. With Steem power, you have influence. With Steem dollars, you have stability. So we've sort of separated the leverage and the influence from the stability using these blockchain-based smart contracts. And, through that, people have more tools that they can leverage, and there's kind of more depth and more character to the ecosystem.
Yeah, it's just a state change, a phase change of matter of Steem.
Great. Well,
awesome.
I'm going to get moving, and then Tatiana can wrap up. It was nice doing this. Thank you, everyone, for inviting me.
Thanks, Ryan. Blockchain Health, everybody. Check it out. Ryan's a wise
blockchainhealth.co.
And a cool dude. All right. See you later, Ryan. Bye. So we're going to have to wrap the show up. Unfortunately, I know that there's so many questions still that the audience suggested to us. I feel really bad that I couldn't get to all of them. I'm sorry, Jocko. I'm looking at you, bud. Anyway, if people have questions, maybe they could leave comments in the post. We broadcast on LRN.FM, Liberty.me, Let's Talk Bitcoin, IPM Nation. We're on some new tune-in thing now. I don't even know what that is. We're on SoundCloud, YouTube. So people can leave their comments, and then hopefully Dan and Ned will be able to answer those questions that still remain. And I'd like
we're
to say thank
viral
you.
Than,
thank you.
We're going viral.
Yes, that's us. I'd like to say thank you to all my guests. This was a really, really good conversation. Brian Sovryn, please everybody check out Sovryn Tech and Sex and Science Hour. You can find him online. Brian, were you convinced? Do you feel a little bit more on Team Steem, or are you still a little skeptical? I'm curious.
No, I'm not on the team at all, but I really do appreciate Ned and Scott answering the questions, and I appreciate their time. And, you know, it was a great conversation. A lot of stuff, you know, kind of got out that I think needed to get out. I think the Curation Guild is that's a direction I think a lot of social media needs to be going in. So I'm excited to hear that.
We don't know what else you like, but you can't win them all. I think this was really, really great. Josh, any final words before we part ways with you, and then I'll do our little thing.
No, it is very good to hear a lot of these questions being answered. I'd love to have them on in another 6 months and see where we've headed and watch this economic theory play out. And this is what I love about the entire Bitcoin space is watching these experiments in economics pop out of nowhere and try something. We have a magic word. Tatiana, what should the magic word be for the Let's Talk Bitcoin Network this week?
I think it should be called Steem It Up. S-T-E-E-M. It up, steam it up, baby. I wanted to say thank you to our sponsors, CryptoCompare.com, the BitcoinCPA.com. Please support Free Ross, my website, CryptoMediaHub.com, TatianaMorose.com to get all my music. I'm excited about TatianaMorose.com, that wonderful woman, because she's going to be singing in Amsterdam for my new album tour that we're doing. And Steem is having a fest there the weekend of November 11th. So everybody can go to steemfest.com. They can come hear me play live and give me all your Steem. I'm sure we'll be live broadcasting it, all sorts of good things. Josh will be joining us. Dan, Ned, any final words for our audience to give them a little love before we jump off the air?
I just have to second that and say, hey, make it to Steem Fest in Amsterdam in the beginning of November if you can. I think it's going to be a great time. It's going to be one of the first big Steem events, completely community organized. Dan and I had practically nothing to do with it. There are other meetups popping up all around the world. There's one in Johannesburg at the end of October. I've just been informed that some people are organizing one in Berlin early next year. So there's all sorts of community events happening, and you know, we're really excited about participating and just being involved with all this community fun and excitement.
Excellent. Okay, well, thank you, everybody. Check out my upcoming show schedule on TatianaRose.com. We've got PubCon in New York. We've got, I don't know, all sorts of fun
stuff.
I'll
be there too, actually.
Latin American Bitcoin Conference, suckers. I better see you all there. All right, everybody. Thank you so much for being good sports. This was really fun. Thank you to our audience for tuning in, and we'll see you next week on The Tatiana Show. Thanks.